Last video, we have explored a format string vulnerability from the protostar examples, but had it compiled on a modern system with ASLR and 64-bit. At first I thought we couldn't solve it, but explored some tricks and played around with it, but then actually figured out a reliable technique. So let's explore some more of the format levels. Format 1. At first, looks very simple. Remember last time we just failed because it required that we write to target the exact value hex.deadbeef? But here we just have to write something. Let's have a quick look if our trick still works. So this level also takes an argument, but passes it directly to printf. No sprintf and buffer involved. Anyway, we compile it again on our 64-bit Ubuntu version and open it in GDB. Then we set a breakpoint at the if compare of target, run it, and as arguments we use AAAA. Then we have a look at the stack. See how our A's don't show up? Where are they? Let's keep looking further down. Oh wow, they are all the way down here. And what's all this stuff again? Well, so see, we didn't copy our string input to a local variable like buffer did in the last challenge. We directly print the arguments, and the arguments are placed along with the environment variables all the way at the start of the stack. So these are the environment variables, and you see there's no stack address we could override and abuse like we did last level. That sucks. But actually, it's still solvable. We don't need the trick from last video at all. It's simpler than you might think. But let's explore that with the next challenge, format 2. That one we haven't looked at yet, and it boils down to the same thing. It looks a bit more promising, right? It does read data into a local variable on the stack, but it doesn't look like we can overflow the buffer. This program gets the input from standard input instead of an argument, and then later target is checked if it's 64. Okay, so let's compile it and open it in GDB. Again, we look for the if compare. Seems to be here, hex 40 is 64, and set a breakpoint, then run it. This time it's waiting for input. So enter some A's and B's, and now we hit the breakpoint, and let's have a look at the stack. We know that our buffer has 512 bytes, and looks like there are a lot of stack addresses in range. But why is that? Isn't the 512 bytes buffer unallocated or empty? Well, not really. You see, it's a local variable on the stack, which means it simply moved the stack pointer further up to make space for it, but doesn't clear it. So these are leftover values from other functions that ran before and had a stack there, which then got destroyed again when they returned, but their values always remain there. For a regular program execution, that doesn't really matter, except that you must not expect a value to be initialized with zero, because you can have bad luck and something was in its place before. Anyway. Let's see where our target variable is. We can use print and then ampersand target to get a pointer, so basically the address of target. But what is that? That doesn't look like a stack address. Somebody who has some experience with exploitation on 64-bit knows already what that is. It's a very recognizable address. With VMMap, you can check the virtual memory and see that it's part of our binary. Look at the permissions for this memory region. It is read and writable, not executable. So it's not where code is, it's in a data segment. When we look at the code, we see that target isn't defined in the function as a local variable. It's a global variable, so it's placed in the data segment. Now, if you have some experience with exploitation 64-bit targets, you also know that that means this address is not affected by ASLR by default. Let's add another printf here, like we did last video to print the address of target. And when we run it a few times, you see target doesn't change. Awesome. So it should be fairly straightforward. Step 1, let's find our input on the stack. We enter some A's followed by %x to print stack values. And here we are, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. At offset 6, we have our input. So we could place our address there instead of the A's and then replace the 6%x with the %n to write to it. Let's try it. So we should now enter our input via echo so we can encode raw characters in hex, then pipe the input into format 2. So let's enter the address of target. Ah, see, there it is, but it's 4 bytes, so there's also a space still included. This has to be a 0 because the address is only 3 bytes. So we add that, but now we don't see any output anymore. What happened? Well, printf prints strings, and strings are null terminated in C, so printf stops when it reached the 0. So we never reach our %x format modifiers. This means we should move our address to the end so we can have format stuff before. Now let's try to find again our address. This time I'm using the dollar syntax to enter an offset directly. So we know our start was at offset 6, so the address has to be further down. Also don't forget to escape the dollar here on the command line because dollar is a special character for the shell. If we keep going with the offsets, we can find the A's. Now sometimes the offset might not be right, so you may have to add or remove a few characters as padding to align it perfectly. Okay, now looks good. Let's change it to a percentage N. Segmentation fault. Well, that didn't work. Let's write our input to a file, OpenGDB, and use that file as input to investigate the crash. So here we are at a move. It tries to move whatever is in R15D into address in RIX. And so RIX appears to be an invalid address. It's not our target. There is a hex A. And that is obviously a new line. So that's the issue. We are on 64-bit, so we have 64-bit addresses. But we only entered 4 bytes, and after echo is a new line. So we just have to add 4 more null bytes. Okay, we don't get a crash now, but target is still 0. How is that? Let's make it crash again by making the address invalid again. This way we should be able to investigate if our address would be correct and what was written to it. So we see RIX looks good. It only is invalid because of what we changed. Otherwise, it would be great. And so it tries to write R15D to it, and that is 0? What? Shouldn't %n write the amount of characters already printed? Let's think for a second. Oh, of course it's 0, because we didn't print anything yet. Before we do the %n, we obviously have to print something first. So let's add %64D to print 64 characters. Now that's 4 characters long. This means we shifted everything by 4. And in order to line up everything again that the address is at the correct offset, we have to subtract 4 characters somewhere. But luckily we made the padding earlier large enough, and so that's simple. And here we go. It's you modified the target. Finally. Finally, we managed to exploit a simple example on a modern system without much hassle. God damn it. So maybe now you wonder, but the system has ASLR. Why is this address fixed? Well, the system has ASLR, and the system libraries like libc are affected by ASLR, but the binary itself is not affected by ASLR, unless we specifically compile it to be position-independent code. And we can do that with the PIE flag for position independent executable and PIC for position independent code. If we now execute format 2 and check the address of target, then we see it keeps changing a lot. Now it's going to be much harder. Maybe with some strategies from last video it's doable. I'll leave that as an exercise to you watching.